All right. Chemistry, part one. So before we get into this, I want to be very clear and just give a quick disclaimer. This is not a chemistry class. This is anatomy and physiology. And I'm going to teach you just enough chemistry to get you through A&P. Some of this will apply to a regular chemistry class if you take it. Some of it will not, just depending on which chemistry you end up in. So with that being said, I'm going to jump into the periodic chart to get us going. So there's our periodic chart. This is the basic one. For this class, we need to know the first 18 elements of the periodic chart, and we need to be able to put them in order 1 through 18. And that becomes super important because it's critical in being able to determine how these molecules are going to interact with each other, how much they weigh. All of that stuff comes into play by being able to put them in order. This will make sense in a moment. So what we've got here is 1 through 18. I like to split it up into two groups of 9, and then I just do two different mnemonics, and that helps me keep the periodic table in order, keep all my elements in order. So 1, I've got hydrogen as number 1, helium for number 2, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine in that order. So with that, I say Harry helps little bigger boys catch newts or fish. And I'm very strategic in how I put these words together, because you can see I've got a couple of H's. I got a couple of B's. Later on, we add in more of some of these other letters. So it's very important that you just be smart about how you put this together, which words you're using to make your mnemonic happen. So I say Harry, H for hydrogen, H for Harry, H-E for helps, H-E for helium. That way I don't confuse my H's. L-I for lithium, B-E for beryllium, or a B-O for boron, or just a B, etc. All the way down. So that's so important. But what this does is now this starts telling us how our subatomic particles, our protons, our neutrons, and our electrons are going to come together to start combining into some of these molecules. Our second 9, we put in the order 10 through 18, nervous, N-E for neon, naughty, N-A for sodium, that way I don't get this confused. Maggie always says, please stop clowning around. So nervous, naughty Maggie always says, please stop clowning around. And now we're able to list these in order 1 through 18, where we can get the chemical symbol as well as the number on the periodic chart to start putting these pieces together. Now that we have this information and we can list these in order 1 through 18, then we can get into some of the more complicated stuff in the chapter. So we're going to start off with the atomic number. So what I've done here is I've just put up the short list here. I can now list these in order 1 through 18. So I've just got 1 through 18 numbers with the molecular formula, just so I have this as a quick reference guide as I start to go through some of this other material. So the atomic number. So the atomic number is the number of protons. It is a steadfast number. It's not a number that you can ever change. You can never gain or lose a proton. That number is steady. And that's what makes each element unique from each other, is the number of protons in its nucleus. And we find that as the atomic number. So when we see the atomic number, most of the time, it's going to be written as a subscript. So let's say, let's look at our list over here. I'm going to go carbon. So carbon, that's my C, my molecular formula for carbon. I follow up, boom, carbon is number 6. And that tells me that carbon has 6 protons in its nucleus. That's my atomic number. So let's take oxygen. We can look over here. Where's oxygen? Where's oxygen? Oh, there it is. It's number 8. That tells me oxygen has 8 protons in its nucleus. But to be able to figure that out, you have to be able to do this by memory, because I'm going to give this to you when it comes testing time. You have to be able to do this on your own. So let's say chlorine. Chlorine. Where's chlorine? Blah, 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 blah. Oh, there it is. It's number 17. So that tells me chlorine has 17 protons in its nucleus. Now, the atomic mass, you may see it laid out for you as the atomic mass. You may see it as the atomic number. You may see it as the mass number. Doesn't matter. All three different ways of asking for that information, they're all asking the same thing. How much does it weigh? That's what they want to know. How much does it weigh? And so to figure out the weight, what we need to do is figure out how many protons and how many neutrons are in each of these particular atoms and add those together. So we weigh protons and neutrons, molecules in general, atoms in the form of Daltons. So one Dalton is 1.7 times 10 to the negative 24 grams per particle. So that's a tiny number, 1.7 times 10 to the negative 24 grams per particle. That's a Dalton. You need to know that. What we also need to know is every proton weighs exactly one Dalton. Every neutron weighs exactly one Dalton. So every proton is one Dalton, every neutron is one Dalton, and one Dalton is 1.7 times 10 to the negative 24 grams per particle. Now that we have that information, we can start figuring up how much these guys weigh. So, because we want our atoms to be overall electrically neutral and just neutral in general, because we don't want to do more chemistry than we have to because this is anatomy class, what we can say is that the atomic number, that unless it's otherwise indicated, unless something looks fishy, we can presume that the atomic number will also tell us the number of neutrons and the number of electrons, just because we want everything to be nice and easy for us. So C6, carbon. This tells me, the six tells me that carbon has six protons. What it's unofficially telling me is that carbon also has six neutrons and six electrons. And we know that protons, neutrons, and electrons, that's all of the subatomic particles. We combine those together to build this. I took six protons, six neutrons, and six electrons. So every proton, we said, weighs one Dalton. Every neutron also weighs one Dalton. So we're going to add up the protons and the neutrons, but you're probably asking, what about the electrons? Well, the electrons are so small that for this class, we say electrons don't weigh anything. They are actually 1/2000th the weight of a Dalton. So they are, the Dalton's already tiny, and this is 1/2000th of that. That's a super tiny number. So for our class, electrons don't weigh anything. They're not going to count towards the weight of these atoms or elements. So if I've got six protons, and now I know I've got six neutrons and six electrons, but we said electrons don't weigh anything, that leaves six protons and six neutrons. So my mass number, my atomic mass, the weight is going to get listed up here. So for carbon, I've got carbon C6 12. Tells me six of the, it weighs 12 Daltons, this carbon weighs 12 Daltons. Six of those Daltons are actually protons. And that's going to be important for this next step. All right, O8, so we are oxygen. Oxygen, we come back over here, we look, where's oxygen? Oh, there it is, it's number eight. That tells me we got eight protons, eight neutrons, and eight electrons. But electrons don't weigh anything. So 8 + 8 = 16. Chlorine, chlorine 17. So 17 protons, 17 neutrons, 17 electrons. Electrons don't count. So 17 and 17 is going to be 34. And this upper number is the mass number. This lower number is the atomic number. And that's both are important. And we need to understand how both of those concepts work to do well moving forward. Because I will ask you a lot of questions. How much does this weigh? How much does this weigh? And this is how we get there. We look at our periodic chart, and we have to be able to put these 1 through 18. So now that we understand the concept of weight, let's look at our first exception to that rule, and that is isotopes. So isotopes are just atoms with the same number of protons, but different numbers of neutrons. So we have the same atomic weight. I'm sorry, we have the same atomic number, but we have different atomic weights because we all have the same number of protons, but we all have different numbers of neutrons, and neutrons do weigh one Dalton each. So that will affect how much the atoms or molecules weigh, depending. So I've got an example here of what some isotopes look like for oxygen. So the big thing, same atoms with a different number of neutrons. So we want all of these to have the same atomic number. So we find our atomic number. What's our atomic number for oxygen? Oh, there it is. It's number 8. So all of these are going to have 08. They all have 8 protons in them, and you can't change the number of protons. So it's not like we can gain or lose that, but we can gain or lose the number of neutrons that are associated with this. So we know in a normal oxygen with the atomic number 8, I've got 8 protons, 8 neutrons, and 8 electrons. Electrons don't weigh anything. So this is going to get me to 0816. Now 0816 tells me I've got 16 Daltons, 8 of them are protons. That leaves the other 8 have to be neutrons because 8 and 8 gets me to 16. So this is actually not an isotope because we have the same number of protons and the same number of neutrons. If that's the same number, then it is not an isotope. We want different numbers to actually find the isotope, which gets us to our next example, 0817. So this tells me that this oxygen molecule or this oxygen atom weighs 17 Daltons. 8 of those Daltons are protons. So 17 minus 8 is going to actually get me to 9. So that's going to be 8 of them are protons. 9 of them are then neutrons. So 8 protons, 9 neutrons, 8 and 9 are not the same number. So this 100% is an isotope. Just because we have a different number of protons and a different number of neutrons. Those numbers do not match. Last example, 0818. So it weighs 18 Daltons, 8 of which I know are protons. That leaves 10 to be neutrons. So 10 are neutrons, 8 are protons. 8 and 10 are not the same number. So this is also 100% an isotope. That's what we're looking for. So the big thing with isotopes, you have to get same number of protons, but different atomic weights. Same atomic number, different mass number. And we get that variance between the number of protons and neutrons. Be able to recognize that. I'm going to come at you with that. So, down at the bottom here, let's look and find, with a couple of examples I just made up, find the neutrons. Which one of these are neutrons? So let's look at the first one. And I've given you both numbers here. The first one, most of the time, you won't get both numbers, though. So we got helium, He2, 4. So He2 tells me that it's got 2 protons. If it's got 2 protons, it's got 2 neutrons and 2 electrons. Electrons don't count. So 2 plus 2 is 4. This checks out. It weighs 4 Daltons. 2 of those are protons. The other 2 then have to be neutrons because electrons don't count. So this is not an isotope. All right. Beryllium 9, Be9. Well, let's see what the atomic number for beryllium is. Oh, beryllium is number 4. So I know I've got 4 protons in this beryllium. So 9 minus 4 is going to get me to 5. So I've got a beryllium with 4 protons and 5 neutrons. This is an isotope because 4 and 5 are not the same number. All right, carbon 14. The atomic number for carbon is 6. So 6 protons and 6 neutrons, it should be 12. But it's not. It's 14, which means I've got some extra neutrons because I can't have extra protons. Can't change that. So if I know 6 of these are protons, then that's going to mean 8 of them are going to have to be neutrons to get me to 14. So that is 100% an isotope. All right, sulfur, 32. Well, let's find the atomic number for sulfur. Is number 16. 16 plus 16 is 32. So if I've got 16 protons, which is what's telling me there, 16 protons, the other 16 neutrons, that gets me to 32. This is not an isotope because we have both protons and 16 protons and 16 neutrons. All right, so that's isotopes in a quick little nutshell for you. That's part one of the chemistry chapter. Many more parts to come. Stay tuned. Boom.